So now I'd like to go a little bit farther into what's called portfolio theory. And portfolio theory is the idea of how to assemble a good investment portfolio. And one of my favorite websites is www.ifa.com. Index Fund Advisors is the name of the company. And they have lots and lots of good illustrations of portfolio theory in action, and can explain to you far more about portfolio theory than I could in this section of videos. So, what we're going to see here is that, yes, you can diversify a stock portfolio, and that's a lot better than putting all your money into just one stock. One illustration of that is this chart I'm showing here. So on the bottom axis, we have risk level as measured by the standard deviation, how much something swings around, and then the average or annualized rate of return on this axis. And generally speaking, of course, we would prefer to have a low level of risk and a high level of return. Unfortunately, we can't always get both at the same time, but we can achieve better or worse outcomes. So if we had put all of our money into one stock, Alcoa or Caterpillar, you know, these are some successful companies, we would have a pretty high level of risk, though, if we put all of our money into one stock. And, you know, even if we'd put it all into Walmart, we'd have a really great rate of return, but still a pretty darn high level of risk. So generally speaking, we want to make sure we have a well-diversified stock portfolio. So if we had put all of our money into the S&P 500 index, so we had diversified our money over the 500 largest companies on the U.S. stock market, we would have hit, what is it here, an average rate of return of 11%, and this is since 1976, and the risk level is 15. But we can actually do even better than that, because some years when stocks are up, bonds are down, and some years when stocks are down, bonds are up. So if we go ahead and combine some stocks with some bonds, we can actually diversify even more. So say, for instance, this portfolio 80 that they have here is roughly 80% stocks and 20% bonds. And you can see that it actually does even better than this 100% in stocks portfolio. There are even more aggressive portfolios that we might look at here. So this, essentially, this line here is what we call the efficient portfolio frontier. It gives us the best possible trade-off for risk versus return. Now, where exactly you would want to be on this line, that comes down to a lot of stuff about where you are and what your purpose for investing is and what your psychological comfort level is with risk. And it may be that, you know, someone who's getting near to retirement or is just more risk averse might prefer a portfolio that's safer with a lower average rate of return rather than one that's riskier with a higher average rate of return. Notice here also in this presentation of the data, we don't have the idea of a totally risk-free asset that the Mankiw textbook invokes. And, you know, even if we have one-year government bonds, which are about as low risk as we can get, we still get a standard deviation of our rate of return of 1.8% per year. You know, interest rates rise and fall, and we're not going to have any such thing as a risk-free asset. It just doesn't exist out there. So that's another reason why I like this particular presentation of the efficient portfolio frontier much better than that in the Mankiw textbook. So, generally speaking, we think the best thing for most investors is to pick a well-diversified portfolio of different assets. And if we really dug into these portfolios, we would see not only do they have stocks and bonds, but they have some large company stocks and some small company stocks and some U.S. stocks and some stocks from developed countries like Germany and Japan and some stocks from less developed countries like Brazil or India. So really trying to diversify not just between stocks and bonds, but between all sorts of different assets, U.S. government bonds and, you know, Italian government bonds and bonds and stocks and property and so on and so forth. So really, to get the full benefits of diversification, we want to spread our money over these many different what are called asset classes. Asset classes are a group of assets that behave in a similar way.